Thank you. I told you there was a tribe in Madagascar that had discovered this particular peculiar thing, at least their priests did, and now they've got everybody doing it, that they sit with their behinds up this way, their chairs also set that way, and their heads are this way. And of course you understand why that is, haven't you? All understood it now?
No.
Oh, so that might have been some lie that I was telling you. But actually you know that the world is round, of course. And you know the world is round, but you don't really know the world is round, if you understand what I mean. Because when I point out something which is really true and is quite contrary to what you think, you forget that the world is round and that the people in Madagascar are down there, and their heads are this way and their bottoms are this way, and that's it. And it was a dead truth, you see. So this afternoon is a very nice time to discuss these matters on this lovely summer day, and now you have no problem with that, because I'm in Buenos Aires, right? Right? So it's very useful to remember there are different points of view and that things from other sides look differently, and also to take any of the facts that you know very well and review them a little bit every once in a while to see what they really signify. It's funny that the water doesn't spill off down there in Madagascar. It's all right that it stays down here, but how it stays from falling down on the other side is another matter. When I was in college, I was very interested in science, and so interested in science in those days that I had no interest in any of the humanities or anything, because I was so busy, science seemed so much more interesting. I'm not the same way anymore, but I was very one-sided in college, as I think young people should be, and they should be allowed to concentrate 100% on their enthusiasm, because as they get older, they have plenty of time for them to branch out and so on. The best idea is to go as deeply as you can, at least for some people, in some direction, to find out how deep the world can be, and then to spread out. Where if you spread out, you never discover how deep anything really could get. But whatever. So I didn't like the humanities. At MIT, you had to take some humanities, and one of them was astronomy, believe it or not. So I took astronomy as a humanity, which was fine. And the next one, there were things like French literature and all this, but that was out of my, I didn't like that. So, but there was philosophy. That was the next nearest thing that was not completely. We had a professor of philosophy who had a beard and was an older man and mumbled, at least as far as my ears was concerned, he mumbled. And I could understand, really, I swear, nothing of what he said. He sat there and went, and I couldn't understand anything. I remember now what I used to do. I had gotten a small drill, you know, like you have for a home drill, a little piece of metal. I used to sit there with my shoe like this, and I'd drill holes by turning this by hand into the shoe, drilling holes in the sole of the shoe, while this guy mumbled. Well, every once in a while in the mumbling, there would be sort of a moment when a word would come, and then it would go. For instance, it would mumble a stream of consciousness, blah, 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 blah. And that's all I would hear. Well, one day, at the end of the class, the mumbling, he made some kind of mumbling, and then everybody at the end of the class is talking to each other after his excitement, you see. He at last had said something of interest. Of course, I didn't understand it, but apparently my schoolmates did understand, and I asked them what was so interesting that he said at the end. That we have to write a theme for the class. Have to write a theme. I said, on what? Well, on what he's been talking about all year, of course, okay? Well, the only thing I heard during the whole year was stream of consciousness, okay? And that's what I have a right on. But then I remembered my father's question. You see, my question was, what happens to your stream of consciousness, whatever it is, when you go to sleep? So I worked on my philosophy theme. Every day in the afternoon, I'd go up into my room, pull down the shades, get into bed, and work on my philosophy theme. Fell asleep. Then at night, I fell asleep. So twice a day, I fell asleep purposely to watch. Okay? And I watched. What happened? My thoughts as I fell asleep, very carefully, not just one night. See, it takes a lot of time sometimes to be careful. You have to start to think, and then you're not satisfied with it. You ask yourself the question, was it really right that way? Let me check it again, do it again, do it again, do it again, and see what happens. And what I finally came to was exactly what you said. My first experience is, well, what made me think of that? and then I couldn't find it. And that happened more often, and that gave me the clue. And then I'd watch and I'd see that ideas would come in that appeared to be logically related. That is, you didn't get the feeling that they were logically disconnected unless you were conscious and watching what they really were about. And then you saw carefully that they weren't connected logically. It was an illusion. You begin to get an illusion of logical connection. When the continuity of our stream of consciousness is becoming quite disjoint, and as you suggested, independent thoughts are coming in from all directions, and they're not connected, although for a long time you think they are. And then, since you think they are, because that's your experience during the day, you try to back it up. That's why I asked you, because I thought my experiences during the day were possible to back up, but the ones during the night were not possible to back up. And I'm only telling you about this experience to tell you how, starting with such ideas that my father would start me on, you can keep chasing these things and find all kinds of stuff. Well, anyway, I wrote the theme, and there was a problem about the theme, which I wrote rather silly at the end. I tried to explain that all I was able to do, of course, was to discover how it felt, what has happened to your stream of consciousness as you fell asleep, under those circumstances that you were watching yourself. Okay? And I pointed out the standard difficulty of introspection is always that if you try to figure out how it happened, you can only figure out how it happens under those circumstances where you're watching yourself, which may or may not be what happens when you're not watching yourself. And so I made some kind of a little poem at the end, finally, about this idea. It said, the poem, the stupid poem, I said, the well-known poem, but of course I made the dippy thing up. I said, I wonder why, I wonder why. I wonder why I wonder. I wonder why, I wonder why, I wonder why I wonder. So, all right, that was my theme. So, okay. So I go to class. So I go to class the next time, and he's decided he's going to, at the different themes, and he's going to read a theme. He reads somebody's theme. Blah, 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 blah. He's another guy's theme. Blah, 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 blah. Aha! That's my theme. I didn't even know he was reading my theme until the end. And then he asked, in the theme I said that I thought, by talking to myself, by making words in my head. And he said, how many people think that they think? That's absurd, he said. How many people think that they think by speaking to themselves in the head? Not one of those suckers had the nerve to put up his hand but me. That was he then. At any rate, I got passed on the philosophy on that experience, but something happened as a result. Because I got in the habit of watching it, although there was a certain date that the theme had to be written, I couldn't stop this habit, see, so I would watch all the time. And then I had the terrific experience discovery that I was watching my own dream, that this time it wasn't just falling asleep, it was a real dream inside sleep, and the extra mind was watching, okay? And it started out as dreams do. This is an absolutely silly dream, so I have no excuse for this, but that's the way, you all know that's the way dreams are. In the beginning, I'm riding on a freight car or something on the top, and we go under a tunnel. You see, and I have to duck because I might be, and I think, yes, you can feel fear in a dream, okay? Then the next scenes or so, I'm in the car, walking in the car along, you know, the railroad car, and it jerks. And I say, you could get kinesthetic feeling in a dream, you know, you could, oh, you see in color. Many people don't, some people do. I was definitely see the images in color. And then at the end of the car, there was a kind of window, like a store window, you see, and instead of mannequins, there were three beautiful girls in nice bathing suits there. So I walked past there, and to the next car is a subway, and I'm hanging on to the strap of the subway, thinking again about kinesthetic things, and I think, you know, they were pretty girls. If I would go back and look at them, I wonder if I could have a wet dream at the same time and see how that excitement comes, you see. So I discovered, indeed, that I could control a dream, just like you say. I turned around and walked back into the railroad car, and looked again at this window, and they were three old men with violins.
The primary O-ring were to fail, it's still no big problem because the secondary O-ring might hold.
Yes, right? Sir, it should energize.
But there's a way for the gas to come out, and at least possibly, and that is there's the leak test port that you put in to make a pressure to test the O-rings. And I wonder how good we can expect. How was it sealed? How is it closed? And how good is it? Can we guarantee that that might not fail? That is, the gas come out through the hole that you used to put the pressure on to test the O-rings to see if they were okay earlier on.
Yes, sir. That is installed to a torque requirement and inspected and signed off that it is installed to that torque requirement. And then there's extensive test data that indicate with that test plug, and it has the O-ring sealing surface also at that torque, will not leak at 1,000 PSI. But if a human error was made and the test port plug was left out, obviously, and you went by the primary seal, that would be a leak source. Or if it wasn't properly torqued, there could be a leak source through there, which could lead to failure of the secondary O-ring.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman?
We spoke this morning about the resilience of the seal, and if the material weren't resilient, it wouldn't work in the appropriate, or it would be less satisfactory. In fact, might not work well. I did a little experiment here, and it's not the way to do such experiments, indicating that the stuff looked as if it was less resilient at lower temperatures than the temperature of ice. Does your data agree with this feature that the immediate resilience, that is within the first few seconds, is very, very much reduced when the temperature is reduced?
Yes, sir.
Oh.
In a qualitative sense, I just can't quantify that at this time.
No. Then you would say that, I would conclude from that and the various things that you told me about the need for resilience and the lack of resilience within the first few seconds. Of course, it comes back very slowly, but too slow to... Isn't it true, then, that the temperature... A low temperature increases the chance of a joint failure?
The low temperature increases the time that will be required for the O-ring to extrude into the gap.
Yes, and presumably...
And that would allow greater erosion on the O-ring. Yes, sir.
Did you have available, is there was some kind of a temperature limit then on when you would say a seal was safe? Was there some kind of criterion that if the seal was lower than a certain temperature, we cannot consider it safe enough?
Yes, sir. The data that we had, and as I stated, we're running extensive testing to understand the response of the seal under the specific conditions of 51L. But the data available to us was the procurement specification for the material that says that it will operate from -30 to 500 degrees F. And also a great deal of test data in motors down at temperatures where you can see a difference in the resilience of the seal. For instance, going from 75 degrees down to 50 degrees, you can see that. We had those data available. We had data that was presented on the 27th by Morton Thiokol, some test data that indicated a further reduction in the resilience of that if the temperature was down to 20 or 25 degrees. However, it was the judgment that with the resilience that we saw there, the shrinkage of the O-ring, and under the circumstances of the leak check that is done, that at that temperature, the O-ring would perform its function. Now, we're the data that we did see is refuted by some other test data. And that is why we are carefully running controlled tests under the specific conditions of 51L to understand the response of that O-ring seal and will it perform its function in that environment.
Of course, after the event, there's a different circumstance, and I'm not really considering that. It's not a fair question. It could be that we didn't notice the circumstance. I just want to know, before the event, from information that was available and understanding that was available, was it fully appreciated everywhere that this seal would become unsatisfactory at some temperature? And was there some sort of a suggestion of a temperature at which the SRB, I guess you call it,
yes,
shouldn't
sir.
Be run?
Yes, sir. There was a suggestion of that. To answer the first question, first, the data that was presented, it was the judgment that under the conditions that we would see on launch day, given the configuration that we were in, that the seal would function at that temperature. That was the final judgment. There were data presented as we have discussed, by some by thiokol engineering, that there was a suggestion that possibly the seal shouldn't be operated below any temperature that it had been operated on previous flights.
Thank you. Other questions?
But I just have to tell you about this interaction. It works like this. I did already say last time, I gave an example of a problem and showed you what an interaction was, and I'll do it again. If an electron wants to go, let's suppose we have a problem where an electron starts here, it's an electron. Now I'm going to use colors. Good. Photons will be blue, electrons will be black because of that. So hereafter, all the electrons that are moving around in this game are black, and the photons are blue. And the typical idea is that an electron can go from one place to another, and then go from that place to another, and so forth. That at a particular place, a photon always is emitted by an electron, or absorbed by some other electron, or maybe goes on forever out of the system, to be absorbed on the moon, perhaps. Let's say we would like to have a photon absorbed here at that moment, at that point, and we had an electron that started here and we want it to end here. So the electron goes from this particular place in space and time to this particular place in space and time, and the photon is supposed to arrive here. One way it can happen is that the electron goes from this point, which I might call point one, to some other point, which I might call point four, and finally arrives at point two. Whereas the photon goes from four to point three. So this would be the typical amplitude. I would draw a picture like this, and I'll tell you how to calculate it. Let's suppose I wanted to calculate the amplitude. An electron goes one to three, one to two, and the photon appears at three. One way this can happen is one way, only one way, is that it goes this particular way, and I'll call that via four, and you'll see what that means in just a minute. It means the electron goes from one to two via going through point four. And the photon appears at three, coming out of four. Then the amplitude for this process is the following number, arrow. It's the following. I'll write it all down and you see if you can't understand it. The product, remember how we multiply arrows? We multiply the arrows. These represent arrows. The arrow corresponding to an electron going from one to four, which for some reason, I seem to have written these backwards. No, I know. I discovered from experience that to do it the way physicists write it is unnecessary for beginners. It's only a convention, so let's do it the way it looks common sense. You go from one to four. Then the electron goes from four to two. And the photon goes from four to two. Four to three. Okay? And there was an interaction. Let's make this nice thing always happen in red. And then we multiply these together. But the rule for multiplication was explained before. They rotate and shrink. So you figure out what each one of these arrows is, then rotate and shrink. So this is nothing but a shrink. It always says when you have an interaction, shrink the amplitude by this factor, 0.098, whatever it is. I don't remember the number. Okay? I can remember the square upside down, but I can't remember the square root. So whenever a photon comes out or in, like this, and you draw this, that's where the C appears, the shrinking, each time you emit or absorb a photon. And the motion of electrons going from place to place is always governed by this, and the photon always by that. And by that way, in that way, you can figure out the amplitude for anything, because a whole world of electrons and photons, at least, There's nothing but these three processes combined in various ways. That's all. It's done. One point, however, if all I knew was that the electron started here and ended here and the photon ended here, this isn't the right amplitude. Why? And what would you do to do it right? Huh? What? Yes, you don't know where 4 was. This is the hour if it happened to do it there. But it may have been that number 4 somewhere else. It might have been this point is here, or here, or here, or here. And for each of those points, there's a total amplitude. Those are alternative possibilities. Those amplitudes have to be summed. So we could say, we have to finish this for this particular problem by saying sum on all possible places, locations, and times that I've labeled 4. Sum this. Make this arrow for every place and add them all together. The square of this would be the probability, the square of this mess, would be the probability that if an electron were liberated here and were found later here, that you'd find a photon in the detector over there at that moment. All right? That's a special problem, and that's the answer to it, almost. I have to tell, there are always more diagrams, more pictures, more ways. Because this electron might have emitted a photon which was later absorbed by the same electron later, and all kinds of terrible things, which I now will explain. So let's take another problem. Well, this is a good one, but we'll leave it there, but we can take other ones to show how it's done. Suppose that I talk about what's called, usually called the scattering of two electrons. One starts at a certain moment from some place, and another starts from a moment from another place, and later you find them in two other places. And therefore, we have an electron that may have got from here to here, and the other one may have got from here to here. Now let's calculate the amplitude for that. Let me call these positions 1, 2, 3, 4. And I'm going to make a few mistakes. I'm going to rush fast, and you're going to have a few mistakes we'll come back and fix. First of all, for this problem, and I'm drawing this line to save the other thing for the blackboard, for this problem, the answer is simply E12 times E34, right? Electron went from 1 to 2, electron went from 3 to 4. Okay? Anything else? Any remarks? Finish. Not quite. Yes, a photon can go. Not from 1 to 4. But you could have a situation like this. This is the first picture. I haven't got room on a blackboard. I just love to keep this one. Well, let me erase this and make the picture smaller. So this first picture is now redrawn. Here's 1 and 2 and 3 and 4. Now this is now going to be the basis for the second picture. The second picture has a new possibility. That is that the electron went from 1 to 4 or 5 and emitted a photon. And the other electron went from 5 to 6 and picked it up. Yes, and what we're asking for now is the amplitude, a new problem, this part of this section, amplitude of electron originally at electrons at 1 and 2 go to 3 and 4. All right? What's wrong?
No, but isn't time going that way? You mean 1 and 3?
1 and 3 go to 2 and 4?
Yeah.
Of course. You're absolutely right. Electron 1 at 1 and 1 at 3 go, respectively, to 2 and 4. Okay? Now, this was the first term. That corresponds to this possibility. But this is also a possibility. And for this possibility, I'll write it down. I'm not going to write anymore because you'll see very quickly what that is. I'm learning the principle. You're not going to actually calculate these. We don't know the formulas. But this would be things like E51. This was times, you remember, in the normal business of time. Times E25, times E63. How brainy do you have to be to write this down, huh? 4, 6, times, wait a minute, now we've got to get a blue one. Yes, you do. Yes, you do. Times P56. Times more? Yes, more. More? Yes, more. C times C. Anything else? Oh, yes. Sum. All places. For five. And for six. Okay? Well, you get the principle now. You have all these things happening. You need to multiply the amplitudes for all the things that are happening. What are those C's? Those are the junctions. For each junction, for each interaction, we have a factor C, or an amplitude C, a shrinker. And all of these are the amplitudes for the things to do what they have to do. Now, I have some questions for you. One, what about the possibility this photon simply comes out here instead of going over here and get absorbed? Why don't I add that in?
Different event.
Got it. We asked for a special event. We started with electrons at 1 and 3. We ended with electrons at 2 and 4 and nothing else. Something else is a different event. If I were asking for the question, we started with electrons at 1 and 3 and we want to have electrons at 2 and 4 and a photon at 17, that's a different problem and we start all over again. Okay? You learned that because that was worrying you before. Right. Okay? I mean, in our conversations, the half-hour conversations, that was the thing that was bothering you. Are we finished? Is this the complete amplitude for this process? No. There are other possibilities that two photons go across and so on. And they write down very much more elaborate strings of these things. And adding this all together is a kind of a technical job of some complexity. So as the diagrams, and these are diagrams, they're called Feynman diagrams, actually. As these diagrams become more complicated, they were invented by your speaker. As they become more complicated, each diagram represents a term in a sequence of terms. No, actually, they weren't. They get more complicated and there's more calculation needed to compute them. So how can we make any calculations? We got the whole string. We're saved in electricity by the fact that this C is small. And the more C's you have, the more shrinkings you do, each by a tenth. And the contributions, there's two of them here. This is a hundredth the size of that, roughly speaking. And then a hundredth again, and a hundredth again. So if we wanted to calculate the one part in 10 to the eighth, we'd just go laboriously to the 10th order diagram. Fourth order. Four extra photons going across, okay? The C is a shrinker, right? It shrinks by a factor of 10. I have here two C's. So in this amplitude, I have shrunk it twice by a tenth, so it's not very big. In the next one, if I had two photons, I'd have four C's. Each one is a shrink, and they go shrink, 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 shrink. I can hardly see it, and so on. Okay, that's what I meant. Yes.
right. We have a doctor in the house, so I have to check. But it's really quite curious. She nodded yes. Either she's being polite, or I'm roughly right.
She nods yes.
Not yet.
Well, she doesn't know. She wants to. You know, doctors sometimes answer when they don't know.
She nods yes.
I wanted to talk about something else, and you'll find out what it is immediately when I tell you a story. And this happened to me as an experience I had. I had a little idea to at a new class, in the physics class, rather advanced physics, that I was teaching. And the students that were coming in were heterogeneous, that is, they were, I didn't know what their background was. In order to find out at what level they were, so I'd know what to teach, I did a little thing for the fun. I said to them, I wrote a series of equations. I said, all right. Now, you may not know any of these equations. It doesn't make any difference. I'll explain what I did. I says, how many are familiar with this equation? That's for what? Elementary laws of mechanics that the first year students should know. These were graduate students, and they sort of all laughed. 100% of them put it in. They all knew that equation. Well, just to start the joke. But then our next equation was some things like a little more complicated, having to do with electricity. So, you know, how many of them got that one? Knew that one. And most of them knew that. And then I wrote something which involved relativity theory. Same electrodynamics in another way. It was more obscure. And I got half of them saying they knew that. This is to find out what the backgrounds were. Right. And I kept going like this, writing more rapidly. To find out if they knew quantum mechanics, if they understand this equation, you see? And yes, they understood this equation. That's the Schrodinger's equation. And then I wrote another one, which is more advanced, relativity and the Schrodinger equation. It's called the Dirac equation. They knew that. Not very many. They were getting down. And finally, and I wrote something about general relativity, you see. A few of them knew that. And then I wrote this following equation. V double dot T equals 1 over C double dot R. Now, how many of you know that equation? And one guy raises his hand. I said, that's very interesting, because this is a new equation that nobody has discovered yet. And everybody laughed, just like you did. And then, so that was the idea, because he went too far. He believed something, he told me that he understood something that wasn't there.
How did you gut feel?
That's it. I hadn't thought of that when I made this up. What happened is, the gentleman who came in was a Japanese man. He had never, it was his first year, it was first time in the United States. He had just started in the class, in the school, in the United States for the first time. And he came to me and he tried to explain that he was not a liar.
Oh, dear.
That he didn't understand what I said. And when he said he obviously didn't know when I exactly said when he raised his hand, and it was tears in his eyes. And that everybody had laughed at him. And they lost face, which is extremely important in Japan. And he was offering to resign from the course and from the school because his teacher thought he was alive, you know. So, and of course, I felt absolutely because you make up a joke, you don't know what you're doing, it's going on all right, it's a happy idea. Just for fun. I mean, everybody's going on. They're all, and we all were laughing a little bit because we realized there was something wrong with his answer. It wasn't that he was a dirty liar. It was obviously something like that, that he misunderstood it or something. It was just a thing that had happened. So I didn't know what to do, but what I did, which is not relevant to this, was I said I was felt terrible, of course, as you could imagine. Absolutely awful. Because it was terrible to see a man under those circumstances with tears slightly, you know, trying to maintain his dignity and all this stuff under the circumstances. And I said to him, please, there are two cultures, there are differences in cultures. It all has to be a difference in culture. And you're not here long enough and we don't understand each other. And I didn't mean anything like that. And nobody, people who were laughing were not really laughing at you, they were laughing at the situation. And they all appreciate there was something mixed up, like maybe you didn't understand it or something like that and so on. And I worked on him and I worked on him, and I told him please to stay, because he hadn't been long enough that in America we have a different attitude, we're much more relaxed and this, so on, so on. And it didn't mean anything personally, it was a hell of a job. But he stayed in the class and everything was all right. Now I was obviously unlucky to have done this in the first place, but lucky in another respect that he came to me and I had a chance to do something. Now the question would be, if we want to talk about, is what happens, let's suppose that somehow or other I hear that someone tells me that this man, an advisor for the school or something, tells me this man came to him and said he was resigning from the swing with tears in his eyes, and he would leave. He had to leave because his teacher had called him a liar in front of the whole class, laughed at him, and so forth. And he felt terrible. He'd go back to his parents and tell them he was a failure and all of it. Harry Carey was around the corner. Okay? Or even if he does commit Harry Carey, let's make it good. Okay, what do you do? Yes, exactly.
Double Harry Carey.
That's right, double Harry Carey. It's a feeling of terrible, I call it remorse. I don't know if I'm using the word right. I think it is the right word. Remorse for having done something like that.
So I have my own remedy, which I've never tried.
It's theoretical, is that it?
Well, I think that what I would like to suggest, I would like to, because when we're talking about idiosyncratic thinking, we're trying to talk about thinking. And the question is whether thinking can solve these problems to some extent. This kind of thinking of what really is the situation, trying to get closer to the reality. And the reality in the world is that the world is more complicated and less understandable than we like to think, and that we can't blame ourselves exactly for being a bit dopey when we make mistakes like this. And that's the only way we can recover, I don't mean the only way, but it's a very good way to recover from the situation. Either say, yes, we make a mistake. You don't mean it quite like that. I'm sure. You say, yes, I made a mistake, I'm going to not do that trick anymore. Or I'm going to be a little bit more careful about this and that. Not too careful.
Yes.
Because otherwise you destroy yourself, your sense of humor, you can't walk around anymore because you'll tread on eggs everywhere. You're afraid that everything you're going to do is going to do this again. You're afraid of remorse. You're afraid that you won't be able to cure yourself of the next case of this disease, and that we also have to avoid. But it seems to me that it's good to practice this, and I know some of you already have that nature, that solution, and others maybe don't. But the problem is, and that's why I'm talking about thinking, I think thinking is a way to peace of mind, and the quiet understanding of the way, first of course there's nothing you can do, the remorse is the strong emotion, and it's like anger or anything, or fear or whatever it is. You haven't got time to figure out what to do. But after a while, as it begins to gnaw away at you, you've got to do something. You do something. One way is to let time pass and bring it up every once in a while, and then try to put it away because you'd rather not remember that and all that horror business. The other way is to take the view like Edith or Sandy or was talking about, and trying to figure out why you have it. Just like you said, you're blaming yourself. Now, is it really, did so badly? You tried, of course it wasn't intended, but we know hell is paid by good intentions, but that doesn't mean we can avoid hell by bad intentions. Let's just remember that principle, okay? But you can't avoid hell by bad intentions. This is hell. And we take it to be a reality and understand it that way. What I am trying to say in the discussions we've been having is that it's surprisingly wonderful, after a little practice in thinking, that you can do things like this, that realize that the regret is a funny emotion. It doesn't make sense. It's talked about by everybody and everybody has it. But if you think about it a little bit, you can control it. There's a way out. It's not necessary. I've taken other examples, like hope and so forth, and I haven't got him yet to understand that the hope is a certain amount of cause of lack of peace of mind. Mm-hmm. But the hope isn't as necessary. I haven't convinced him yet. I'll get back to him. That you can do things, that this business about the man who with hope is able to trudge through the snow, whereas if he had less hope and didn't force himself to trudge, I must go on, I must go on, I must hope, there's nothing left but hope. That is the most clear statement of desperation I've ever heard. There's nothing left but hope. Instead, think about what is left and what the possibilities are. Then instead of trudging stupidly through the snow, onward and onward to your death, you get the idea from quietly analyzing whether to be quiet, to dig a hole in the snow, and to breathe quietly so you can last longer, to find some way, do something, to go out and make an SOS, to decide to stay with the wreck because it's more likely to be found. Using your head instead of using emotion might, in the end, be a quieter way to meet your death, if it's really true that you're going to die there at the airplane, whatever imaginary situation we have. Because the meeting death is also a game that we have to learn how to do and realize what it is. It's an inevitable reality of the world. And you say, well, like man, we must struggle, man. Those are propositions. It turns out it's not necessarily so. Many people have died very calmly and very contentedly. And I'm sure almost always that they're thinking people. Okay? Except those that have a myth that they're dying comfortably because they're going to go to heaven. But you can't have that myth anymore. You're always afraid. You see, even that one doesn't work because the opposite possibility exists that you go to hell. There's not many people that have the self-confidence that they've done so well, except for certain monks and so on have done nothing.
Is the absence of something bad?
No, it's not bad. It's not bad. Yeah, but the only way you can think that you've done all right and you haven't done anything bad and you're bound to go to heaven is that you didn't do anything.